Good afternoon and evening, and thank you for attending the National Pancreas Foundation's 16th Annual Fellow Symposium. My name is David Bakelman. I'm the CEO of NPF. On behalf of our Board of Directors and Fellow Symposium Committee, we can't thank you enough for your involvement and attendance in this afternoon and evening's Fellow Symposium. Thank you so much. It's your involvement and support this evening that will continue to allow NPF to impact more patients and research in the future to address all forms of pancreas disease. Again, thank you. This is the third year in a row that we're not in person, and we, the committee and our board of directors, made the decision that it would be safer to go virtual, but we're really excited to go into next year into San Diego, California. I know all of you are probably Zoom experts by now, but before we get started with our fellow symposium, I want to review a couple of webinar tips to maximize your experience with this evening and make sure the impact is the most possible this evening. So just a couple of tidbits. The first is your personal audio and video. Your audio, video and audio are automatically off for the webinar. Please keep them off during the duration of our fellow symposium. Panel discussions and questions. During the panel discussions, we will take questions placed in the Q&A tab. The Q&A icon or command bar is typically found across the bottom of your screen. With this open, you'll be able to easily submit questions at any time during our fellow symposium, and we really encourage questions. And within the Q&A tab, you may also upvote submitted questions, which bubbles the most popular questions to the top of the list for our fellow symposium moderator. To upvote, simply click on the thumbs up icon next to any question in the Q&A panel. During the Q&A, you may also participate and ask live questions by raising your hand sign, so our technical crew this evening can bring you up on the screen, at which time you will need to turn on your audio to speak and ask your questions. The next tidbit is our chat window. The chat window is available for one-on-one conversations with our panelists, as well as other attendees and audience members during our webinar. Please do not hesitate to submit questions in chat, or they will be missed. And again, we're really encouraging questions this evening. The internet. I know that we have attendees from all over the country. So if your internet goes down, to rejoin the program, use the same link in the email that you received over the last couple of days, and you should quickly return to our fellow symposium. And if you have any technical problems during our fellow symposium, at the bottom of the screen, we have listed a technical support number to text or call. So please take advantage of it. Our technical team will also be placing links into the chat window for our contest during our fellow symposium, as well as a breakouts at the end of our session, which are also in your confirmation email. Trivia, not only the educational components of our fellow symposium, but we really wanted to add a little fun to it. So to make things a little more fun, we're adding some pancreas trivia today for our NPF fellow symposium for our fellows. There will be six trivia questions sprinkled throughout our evening. Answer all six questions correctly, and you will be entered in a chance to win a $50 Amazon gift card. You can find the link to the survey page in the program of the chat window. You'll be answering trivia questions, the trivia questions at the same link. So keep it open throughout our afternoon and evening, and don't submit until you've answered all the final questions or final question, or you won't be able to play along. Let's get everyone off to a great start with our first trivia question. Open the chat window and click on the SurveyMonkey link to answer the first question. Now, don't hit submit until the end of the fellow symposium, and be sure to keep your window open to add your answers to the other five questions throughout today's program, and good luck. I hope everyone enjoys our fellow symposium this year. Again, thank you for your attendance. I know it will be a great experience for everyone this afternoon and evening. It's my pleasure at this time to introduce our National Pancreas Foundation Chairman of our Board of Directors, Dr. Dana Anderson. Dana, please take it away.
Thank you, David, and thank you all for joining us in this 16th annual Fellows Symposium of the NPF. This project began in 2006, has been fantastically successful, has grown from its initial group of 20 fellows, and now accepts up to three times that number. And many of our initial fellows now serve as expert faculty for the symposium itself. And you'll hear from several of them in the course of this symposium today. We're very grateful that the NPF has really supported the careers of multiple experts in the area of pancreatic disease. And this fellows symposium is one of the first steps along that pathway. It wouldn't be possible to put on this symposium without the support of several supporters, including AbbVie, in addition to Medtronic and Immunovia and Ionis and Ipsen and Novocure. And we thank all of these sponsors for their support of this educational program. There are a number of great topics in adult pancreatitis, pediatric pancreatitis, and pancreatic cancer that are going to be covered by our faculty in this symposium. And I hope that you'll stick around for the breakout sessions at the end of the symposium, where you'll be able to ask questions. You know, the thing that's characterized this symposium in past years is that this is an informal group. We like to relate to each other in first names. We like to answer questions from everyone. There is no such thing as a stupid question. So we want you to feel free to engage us in those breakout sessions to ask us to clarify something that we've gone over perhaps a little too quickly, or just to ask us about advice as to how you should proceed with your specific interests in pancreatic disease. And so without further ado, I'd like to introduce the moderators of our first session, Dr. Eileen O'Reilly from Memorial Sloan Kettering and Dr. Tim Gardner from Dartmouth. Please take it away.
Well, thanks, Dr. Anderson, and it's really a pleasure to be here as the moderator. I have the pleasure to be the moderator for the first two sessions, which are going to be Pancreatology 101, what we know and don't know, and then screening for pancreatic cancer. So we're going to start our first presentation with a presentation on Pancreatitis 101, what we know and don't know. And we're going to begin with Dr. Forsmark's presentation. So we'd like to welcome Dr. Chris Forsmark from the University of Florida to give this talk, Pancreatology 101, What We Know and Don't Know. Dr. Forsmark.
Welcome to the National Pancreas Foundation Fellows Symposium. My goal in the next 15 minutes is to talk a little bit about what we know and, more importantly, what we don't know about treating patients with pancreatic disease. And I'll spend a little time talking about some things we know and should be doing, but sometimes don't do consistently. So I'm going to start with a patient. This is a 46-year-old woman admitted with an episode of acute pancreatitis. She looks pretty sick on admission. She's tachycardic and hypotensive, but afebrile with an oxygen saturation of 85%. The initial physical exam is notable for rather significant distress due to abdominal pain and dyspnea. Initial laboratory tests show hemoconcentration and an elevation of BUN, as well as an elevation in the white count. And the liver chemistries are abnormal with a bilirubin of 2 and AST and ALT in the low hundreds. An abdominal ultrasound reveals gallstones, the presumptive cause of her episode of pancreatitis. But the common bile duct is non-dilated and no common bile duct stones are noted. And so a number of questions might come up if you were managing this patient. Should you perform a CT scan now, for instance? Would you admit the patient to an ICU? If you were going to give fluid resuscitation, what would you give? How much would you give? And when would you determine that you had reached a sufficient amount of resuscitation? Would you give antibiotics or not? Would you recommend an ERCP now or later? Would you offer artificial nutrition like TPN or tube feeding? And when would you anticipate that the patient might need a cholecystectomy? So if you think about it, those therapeutic questions really are focused around what did is it that we're trying to prevent in a patient like this with acute pancreatitis? What are the important outcomes? And if you read the literature, mainly what you see are those things that are listed on the right-hand side of the slide. The severe pancreatitis is defined by organ system failure and necrosis. But if you think about it from the perspective of a clinician and a patient, what's important is what's on the left-hand side of the slide. Do they die or not? How long is the hospital stay and how much does it cost? Is there a need for some form of intervention? What's the chance they're going to get recurrence after they leave? Can we prevent that, or can we prevent long-term disability, such as the development of diabetes or exocrine insufficiency? And there's a lot of research interest lately on so-called patient-centered outcomes or patient-reported outcomes. These are things that are most important to patients, how they feel and how they function. And these are just beginning to be studied as important outcomes of acute pancreatitis. So as I put this talk together, I made a list of the things that I was taught when I was a fellow and what we actually know now. And it was kind of eye-opening. So when I was a fellow, we were told that the Ransom criteria were highly accurate ways to assess prognosis and predict outcome. As it turns out, we couldn't remember them back then, as nobody else can remember them these days. But what we've learned is that multiple factor scoring systems don't actually outperform an experienced clinician. We thought we had to keep patients NPO for prolonged periods of time to rest the pancreas, and now we know patients can be fed early and safely. We were very much focused on massive fluid resuscitation. We thought it would prevent the progression to severe disease. And now we know that overly aggressive fluid resuscitation can actually lead to a worse outcome. We thought that TPN was necessary to rest the pancreas. And now we know it's risky and rarely needed. We thought that prophylactic antibiotics should be used to prevent pancreatic necrosis from becoming infected. And now we know that prophylactic antibiotics don't work. We had sort of come to the conclusion at that time that if a patient did happen to develop infected necrosis, that we needed to move promptly to open surgical debridement. And now we know that delaying intervention, letting that necrosis become walled off, allows us to provide safer, minimally invasive interventions. We were very much in favor of early ERCP and improving outcome. And now we know that in the absence of concomitant cholangitis, ERCP doesn't actually help. We thought we could delay cholecystectomy for many weeks without risk. And now we have learned that cholecystectomy should be performed at the index hospitalization. And we felt that patients would completely recover pancreatic function. And now we know that a significant proportion actually develop diabetes or exocrine insufficiency with long-term follow-up, even if they have rather mild acute pancreatitis. So what we knew then and what we know now are entirely different. And I'm guessing that as you all graduate and become faculty or practitioners, as you reach the end of your career, there's going to be a whole nother list of changes as to how we manage acute pancreatitis. So when we think about treating these folks, there are a variety of different treatment goals. We want to provide the best supportive care possible, obviously. If possible, we'd like to reduce the inflammation and organ system failure. We'd like to preserve the pancreas if we can. We'd like to predict, assess, prevent, and treat any complications that develop. And obviously, we'd like to prevent mortality and recurrence, and we'd like to maximize this quality of life that the patient experiences after recovery. So what do we know now? What do we know and what don't we know? Well, obviously, fluid resuscitation is one of the pillars of management of patients with acute pancreatitis. And there actually is some science to guide us as to what might be the best choice. There are 7 randomized controlled trials which have taken different approaches. Some have been comparing goal-directed therapy, that is, treating to some goal such as urine output, versus a more standardized infusion. Some have compared rapid to more gradual hydration. Some have compared different types of fluids like normal saline or hydroxyethyl starch or Ringer's lactate. But if you look at this data, it's each of these randomized trials is underpowered, and really none of them give high quality evidence as to what we should do. In the studies comparing rapid versus gradual hydration, there was really no reduction in important outcomes like organ system failure or mortality or necrosis. And in fact, 2 studies with very rapid hydration actually showed a worse outcome with increased mortality. Studies using the plasma expander hydroxyethyl starch have showed it was worse than giving normal saline. And there is a study looking at lactated ringers, which didn't have a clear-cut impact on the major complications, as I've shown you in the previous slides, but did lower the C-reactive protein. And so we don't have a lot of high-quality evidence to actually tell us what we should be doing. And in the absence of high-quality evidence, what we generally get are practice guidelines. And this is just a list of five different organizations who have provided practice guidelines to inform clinicians about how they might think about providing fluid resuscitation. And you can see in the second column is the preferred fluid. Most recommend Ringer's lactate, but not all. In the third column is the rate and timing, and you can see it's all over the board in terms of how fast and for how long. And then there are a variety of different endpoints as well. So this is an area that's ripe for investigation to try to figure out what the best strategy actually is in managing these patients and how much is the right amount and not too much. The same holds true with nutrition. I said full circle because when I was a fellow, we didn't let patients eat or drink at all. That's the upper left panel. And then when they got hungry, we let them have clear liquids in the upper middle panel. And if they tolerated clear liquids, we gave them solid food. And then we became worried that by giving solid food, we would stimulate the pancreas and worsen pancreatitis. So we went to TPN. That's the upper right panel. And then we discovered that TPN was kind of risky, had a lot of infections. And so we said, well, we need to put in a long tube and feed in the distal small bowel. That's the lower right panel. So these long tubes that were kind of challenging to place. And we thought if we fed in that location, we could get the benefit of nutrition, but not stimulate the pancreas. And then people said, well, does it really have to be down that far? So that's the lower middle panel where we use shorter tubes like a nasoduodenal tube. And it seemed like it worked just as well and was just as safe as these long tubes. And people said, well, if you can do that, then why can't you just put a tube in the stomach and feed them? That's the lower left panel. And that seems to be equally effective as these longer tubes. And then people said, well, if you're just going to put a tube in the stomach, why not just let the patient eat? So now we're back to the top left again, where we keep the patient MPO until they feel like eating, and then we let them eat. We don't use the clear liquid strategy anymore. We go right to a solid, low-fat meal. But this whole idea of nutritional support has really come almost full circle, if you will, from where I started as a fellow, and now it's kind of back in the same spot. But another area that's ripe for investigation. One of the holy grails of managing patients with acute pancreatitis is to find something that preserves the pancreas, reduces the inflammation, if you will. And there are lots of different approaches that have been taken. I've listed them on this slide, but none of them launched. And there's a failure to launch, is the picture on the left. None of these actually worked in carefully done studies. And so we don't have an actual therapy that improves the outcome of pancreatitis by reducing inflammation or limiting pancreatic damage. But we certainly need something like that. But so far, strategies, a variety of strategies have been tried and unfortunately all have failed. Now, the other thing about treating these patients is there are certain things we kind of know what we should do. And the question is, do we actually do it? You know, you can know something and you can show somebody that you know it. But the question is, when you're working on your own and nobody's watching you, do you actually do it? So we know that TPN is not recommended in any guideline, but we know it's still widely used, at least in the United States. We know that prophylactic antibiotics are not recommended in any guideline, but they're still widely used. And we know that many patients with gallstone pancreatitis, like the patient that I showed you, actually leave the hospital with their gallbladder still intact, even though the guidelines say that these patients should have their gallbladder removed during the index hospitalization. So sometimes even if we know what to do, we don't do it well. And improving what we do is another area that many of you hopefully in the audience will focus on as you think about your future career. Now, I did the same thing for chronic pancreatitis as I did for acute pancreatitis, sort of what I was taught and what we know now. When I was a fellow, we thought all chronic pancreatitis was due to alcohol, and those who said they weren't drinking were just lying to us. Now we know that genetics and elevated triglycerides and autoimmune and other forms of idiopathic pancreatitis are much more common than we suspected. We didn't know that smoking would hurt the pancreas. We didn't think it would, but now it turns out smoking is just as bad or even worse than alcohol. We thought that if patients came in with a painful flare and their amylase or lipase wasn't elevated, that they could not be having a painful flare. But we know that now that with repeated attacks, the peak amylase and lipase levels diminish, probably due to a loss of Asner cells as the disease progresses. When EUS came out, we thought it would be an accurate method to diagnose the early stages of chronic pancreatitis, but as it turns out, it's too sensitive. There are too many false positives to be accurate for early diagnosis. We thought that celiac plexus block would be an effective treatment for pain, and as it turns out, these nerve blocks don't work that well, probably because the pain has a central component. It's a centrally sensitized pain state, and that really explains the lack of response. We didn't think there was any way to delay progression of chronic pancreatitis, and there are some ways, such as getting patients to stop smoking. And we used to think that exocrine insufficiency was fairly rare and most patients didn't need treatment, and now we know it's fairly common. It has important clinical consequences like osteoporosis, and it often does need treatment. So this is just a list of where I think some important unanswered questions and clinical needs are. And as you think about a career studying disease of the pancreas, I think you can find something on this list that you might want to tackle. In acute pancreatitis, we still need to know what the best practices are. We need to develop interventions that can salvage or protect remaining pancreatic tissue. We have to prevent progression, if we can, to relapsing pancreatitis and chronic pancreatitis. We have to understand how diabetes and exocrine pancreas interact. We have to figure out exactly what it is that patients value and do research that tries to maximize those patient-reported outcomes. We need to do implementation research, which is trying to improve adherence to the best practices. Do we know what to do, but then do we actually do it? And obviously, we need to focus our care so that it's available across the population. The same holds true in chronic pancreatitis, things like reducing stigmatization, where everybody thinks this is all due to alcohol. Early diagnosis is certainly important, as is accurate diagnosis of exocrine and endocrine insufficiency, and biomarkers to help us predict who's going to develop what outcome. We need better interventions, certainly. That's certainly for pain, as an example. We need to reduce the pancreatic cancer risk, and there's an opportunity for studying that. In pediatric pancreatitis, all of these are important, but there are, I think, in that population, the prevention of progression is really essential. And there is this complicated problem of transitioning pediatric patients to adulthood that needs further study. And then the others are similar to chronic pancreatitis: implementation research, focusing on the right outcomes, particularly patient-reported outcomes, health equity and precision approaches. So it's a long list, but if you're interested in studying the pancreas, I think you'll find something of interest on this list. So a final question is, if we don't know what everything, why is it that we don't know? What prevents us from knowing? And there are lots of potential reasons for this. We don't have good disease models. The second one is probably the most important, at least in my mind, and that is in the absence of data, what dominates is dogma. And so people think because it's always been done a certain way, it always has to be done that way. So this lack of our imagination. Another problem up until recently has been a lack of cooperation and developing large-scale clinical trials, although that's improving now, and some other problems as well. And I like this quote from Daniel Borstein, who's one of the great thinkers of our age, who says the greatest obstacle to discovery is not ignorance, it's the illusion of knowledge. And finally, one of the things to think about as you begin your career is it's really important to surround yourself with a group of people who are interested in the same problem. And there's some very successful and very large research and clinical consortium that are now developing across the world. And I've listed a number of them in the left column. And the types of problems they're focusing on are big problems, big clinical problems in pancreatic disease. And that's the column on the right, some of the things that they're focusing on and some of the AIR studies that they've already done. So I think this is important as you launch your career. Think about the questions you want to ask, but think about the group that you can be a member of. And with that, thank you for your attention.
Hello, everyone. Eileen O'Reilly here. I'm a medical oncologist. Chris, thank you very much. That was terrific, really educational and very interesting to see how the world has changed in terms of management of acute and chronic pancreatitis. So thank you for that. So next, we have Professor Michael Goggins, who's from Johns Hopkins, and he's an expert in screening and early detection. He's an NIH-funded investigator for many years and has led the field. So it's a real privilege to have Dr. Goggins here to speak to us all today. And I'll just ask everybody to please queue up their questions. At the end of this, we'll have with the speakers a panel. So thank you. Michael?
A kind introduction, and thank you for the National Pancreas Foundation for inviting me to speak this evening. I'm speaking about screening for pancreatic cancer. I have no disclosures. A brief overview, who, when, and how should be screened. Why are we undertaking pancreas surveillance in 2022? Very briefly, a few of the challenges we face and some comments about some of the emerging biomarker approaches that are potentially clinically useful. To start with, here's a slide that summarizes some of the main points about who, when, and how from our CAPS International Consortium guidelines, as well as the AGA guidelines, and there was an ACG guideline a few years ago. And they're all very similar, and indeed, there's been an update, updated guidelines from the ASG recently, focusing on the BRCA 1-2 question. And these guidelines are pretty uniform and worth knowing. It's mutation carriers and family history folks. The key thing about family history is all of this is trying to estimate an elevated risk suitable to justify pancreas surveillance, which is typically 5% lifetime risk or more. Of course, that's spread out over several decades. So that risk is probably pretty conservative. That corresponds to about a fourfold lifetime risk or higher. And significant questions are when to start surveillance and the role of family history. When these guidelines were first developed, we were very much more in the mode of first do no harm. These guidelines began to take form over 20 years ago. And so over time, we've realizing the potential benefits of surveillance, they have been loosened some, but family history was included early on to try and enrich for people whom the risk might be elevated, but certainly expected to be elevated with a family history of the disease. And in the middle, you'll see when, you know, for many of these patients, it's starting at age 50. Some folks would advocate even later, 55 for folks with a family history. And for some of the more significant mutations, it's age 40. And at the bottom, you see the hows, which we rely on US and MRI for surveillance. And this slide just briefly summarizes the main pancreatic cancer susceptibility genes and what we know about the lifetime risk. And there's many of these such tables, many of you are familiar with them. And these are the genes that we look at for who justifies surveillance. And so again, the main question is, should family history be used to decide surveillance of individuals with BRCA ATM, PALB2 mutations, for example? And this is an evolving question. There isn't a right answer. We don't have quite enough data. We do know that in general, even among mutation carriers, pancreatic cancer risk is elevated if you have a family history. Of course, family history is very important to take, but it's not always informative. And so we're beginning to see more and more people being surveyed. And indeed, even our CAPS program, I personally will now screen folks who are mutation carriers without a family history after careful consultation. And the when is still an important question, bearing in mind that most patients with these risk factors won't develop pancreatic cancer if they're going to do so until their 60s. You're really trying to, median age in 60s, you're really trying to get the, make sure you don't miss folks. But 45 or 50 is what settle on most people would say age 50, but this is still an open question. Pancreatic surveillance relies on EUS and MRI. Here's an example of an MRI scan. Actually, there's innumerable pancreatic cysts here, and that tends to be the focus because there's a lot of cysts detected. Most of these are small and have low malignant potential individually, but they do generate some concern. And the fact that we can detect these has put a lot of emphasis on pancreatic cysts as a the mechanism of pancreatic cancer in these individuals. Whereas in fact, we think that this group of patients, most of them probably developed their pancreatic cancer from panin. And here's an example of multiple different panins of different grades from one patient with, in the CAPS program who had a pancreatic resection. So in fact, a lot of our effort in early years in the program has been, can we identify panin because they're hard to detect by imaging, what kind of strategies, and this is still a challenge that we face. Can we use biomarkers, for example? And so the CAPS program, which is now CAPS 5, which has been in existence since around 2014, is a multi-center program. CAPS originally started at Hopkins, and we now have the 8 centers listed here. And the goal of the program is to develop biomarkers for early detection of pancreatic cancer, and also panin pancreatic cyst biomarkers, and also to understand what the outcomes and of surveillance is, among other things. And it's been funded by the NCI for the last 5 years. Here's an example of a CAPS case from the CAPS 5 program in the US. Above, you see an irregular small mass, suspicious hypoechoic lesion in the pancreas, about a centimeter in size. And below you see the corresponding MRI images. And indeed, that was a pancreatic cancer, a 1 centimeter pancreatic cancer. This is what we're hoping to detect. And that was actually a stage 1 pancreatic cancer. So we're hopeful that it will have a good outcome. A somewhat similar image here, you see a more, little bit more well-defined, not quite as hypoechoic lesion on the top left by US. And also an abnormality concerning on the CT scan. And below you see actually what was found at resection, which was actually low-grade panin. It did have an extensive fibrotic area surrounding it. It was probably some acinar collapse. And this highlights some of the challenges that we face. This patient didn't have any high-grade dysplasia or cancer in the gland. The imaging characteristics weren't clear enough. And and that was an example where we actually saw some of the effects, probably mainly indirect, of the panin. But that still remains a challenge. When we look at the survival of patients with pancreatic cancer or high-grade dysplasia diagnosis in the CAPS 5 program, what you see here is really impressive survival, albeit this Kaplan-Meier is only for the last 4 years. This group is, these haven't achieved long-term survival, but we're seeing a majority of patients with stage 1 pancreatic cancer being detected under surveillance. And survival is quite good. And of course, high-grade dysplasia does have a good outcome. And this builds upon our prior CAPS paper, Hopkins Base, which we published in 2018, showing that patients who develop pancreatic cancer under surveillance, the purple curve, they do quite well. And here you see long-term survival. We've been following patients since that time. That's about 5 years ago when that curve was generated. Compared to patients outside surveillance who have a poor outcome, somewhat similar to no surveillance. Our CAPS 5 results are even more impressive in terms of the stage shift to stage 1 and the associated survival benefits. This also fits with what we've seen. If you look at, now this is just general population, U.S. pancreatic cancer stage one. This is a figure we published in JNCI a couple of years ago, showing the impressive results of patients if they undergo surgery and have stage one disease. They do quite well, really impressive survival after 5 years. And this holds pretty well up for 10 years as well. Briefly about a few potential biomarkers for early detection. There's a lot of interest, of course, in CancerSeq, which was a ctDNA-based test, but also had other biomarkers as well. It's really a multi-cancer early detection test. And this is one of the figures from the paper published in Science a couple of years ago showing the different cancers that were detected. Pancreas cancer, of course, is not common in the general population, so we didn't see any there. But this test has a significant potential for multi-cancer detection and could have a role in pancreas early detection as well. New onset diabetes is a great focus. Any clinician who comes across a patient with new onset diabetes, especially if there's evidence of weight loss, should have some thoughts about pancreatic cancer. The prevalence of pancreatic cancer may not be high, but this is an in that setting, but this is an opportunity. This is a figure from Dr. Shari et al.'s paper in Gastro from a few years ago. And they've done nice work on this. And of course, we have the NOD cohort studies underway. Stratifying CA19-9 levels by genotype. This is work that we have done where if we understand the genetic basis for CA19-9 in an individual, we can develop their own personalized reference range, and that significantly improves CA19-9's diagnostic performance, as shown here. And I figure these curves are based on a paper from a couple of years ago in CGH. CA19-9 alone and CA19-9 with the patient's genotype information. And this is not just the FOOT3 null people. This is an overall stratification, which leads to pretty impressive improvements. Other approaches worth understanding, this segmentation of CT scans to look for early evidence of cachexia and lipolysis, shown here on the CT scan, could have value as a more general early detection tool, the incidental detection of it in people who are having serial CT scans. And since we're not doing CT scans routinely, it may not have a role certainly at the moment for high-risk individuals. And here from Elliot Fishman, a figure which in this case is looking at deep learning to identify pancreatic abnormalities. In this particular example, highlighting the red tumor and the dilated pancreatic duct. This is all generated by artificial intelligence images of those CT scans without any human input. So again, the hope here is that at the very least, these kinds of approaches will be used to help radiologists interpret imaging in the routine diagnostic setting. So in summary, improved risk stratification of pancreatic cancer is needed for better patient selection. We still have some questions about who should be screened and when. And the more we develop understanding of pancreatic cancer susceptibility, the better we'll do it at selecting patients who would be most suitable for surveillance. Pancreatic surveillance of high-risk individuals does downstage cancer, pancreatic cancers. We have significant data about this now. And often these are stage one, which of course is very uncommon in the sporadic setting to develop a stage one pancreatic cancer. And survival from stage one pancreatic cancer is much better than generally appreciated and has been improving in recent years. And in order to have a significant impact, the emerging biomarkers really need to be able to reliably detect most stage one pancreatic cancer, something that they don't do. If we really want to have an impact on screening and survival. And that's it. Thank you. Just to acknowledge my lab and the other CAPS site investigators and my Hopkins colleagues and our funding. Thanks very much.
Great. Thank you very much, Michael. That was excellent too. So welcome everybody to the panel discussion. And just a reminder for our audience to please put your questions in the Q&A. And we have a few that we can get things going. I think this is a good one. So it's from, can you comment on the move away from FNAs? Maybe Michael or Tim or Chris in your gastroenterology role, and I can add in our oncology perspective. Any takers?
Were you speaking more about aiming more for core biopsies from pancreatic tumors with EUS as opposed to the aspiration or going without pathologic diagnosis at all?
Yeah, I think that's the question, that, you know, move toward to core biopsies and just...
Yeah. I mean, I think at least in my place, it's become routine just because there's a need for enough tissue to do, you know, genetic sequencing on, if possible, to plan therapy. So we're, I think, often doing both in these patients. Tim, I'm not sure what you're doing US-wise when you see folks, but I think the core biopsy needles seem to be reasonably safe, and the amount of tissue that you get is more, it's closer to being sufficient for what the oncologists need for decision making.
Chris, I would second that, absolutely. I think as a fellow 10, 15 years ago, it was always scary to use a core needle to try to obtain pancreatic tissue for the malignant and benign. And with our new needle systems, I think it's much better. So yeah, so I think we've been getting away from the FNA, and the FNB is what we've been using, and that seems to be much better.
Yeah, just I think echoing that from the oncology side, we now want to learn as much as we can from these biopsies. And ideally, you know, a core is great. If not, a really good cell block. We can do a lot from that in terms of genomic sequencing. And, you know, I think in the not too distant future, we'll be beginning to define therapy based on some of the initial analysis, if we can do, you know, additional transcriptomic profiles from biopsies. So,
Eileen, yeah. At this point, would you estimate for us what percentage of folks that you see with newly diagnosed pancreatic cancer, are you using that information to choose a specific therapy? Is it still a very small percentage? Is it growing? What's your sense of that?
Yeah, I think it's a small percentage in terms of initial treatment, but the hope is that, you know, in the future, we will be able to go there. But there's clearly a percentage who have, you know, germline BRCA, somatic BRCA alterations. The somatic, obviously, we learned from the tumor. Small subset with KRAS wild-type tumors, where we see other actionable oncogenic drivers, and the occasional patient with mismatch repair deficiency, where you know, immunotherapy may have a role. So yeah, I think this is sort of a big change, I would say, in the last, you know, 5 to 10 years, right, in the oncology, the GI world. Here's one for Michael. So best approach to screening for pancreas cancer in the setting of chronic pancreatitis, and also commenting on some of the data you showed, the genetic variants related to FUT2 and FUT3 and expression of CA19-9, and do you use this clinically?
Yeah, thanks. That's David Whitcomb asking. Good question. The second one first. So we have translated the test into our molecular diagnostic lab, and it should be going live soon. We're approved to use it in our through our RB. So it's a CAPS-5 protocol that patients were in the CAPS-5 study, you know, to evaluate its clinical performance in a trial setting. We're optimistic it'll go live in, you know, in the next few weeks. We'll have more experience soon. The pancreatitis question, that's a question maybe David could answer himself. That's a tough one. You know, we don't see too many hereditary pancreatitis patients in the CAPS program. So, our experience, people on the panel, have probably a good bit more experience than I do about the imaging challenges of whether it's US or any of the modalities for imaging the pancreas in this setting. You'd have to anticipate that some of these folks are going to have more trouble getting early cancer diagnoses.
Great, maybe a couple of ones here. I'm sorry, Tim.
Well, I was maybe going to follow up that to Eileen, just kind of a related topic, that currently at our center, every patient who's diagnosed with pancreatic adenocarcinoma has genetic testing performed for risky genes. And so I was wondering if Dr. Raleigh could probably answer that question. I believe that's an NCI recommendation. Your thoughts on that?
Yes, so thanks indeed. And work from, you know, a number of centers, Hopkins, Mayo, MSK and others resulted in changing the guidelines in, it was only really 2019 that this happened, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network guidelines and the American Society of Clinical Oncology guidelines included routine germline testing for all patients with pancreas cancer and somatic testing, you know, where additional treatment was indicated. So there are a number of trials that build off of this, and one standard of care approach would be using a PARP inhibitor targeted medication in the setting of germline BRCA following initial platinum-based therapy. I mean, we certainly wish this subset was bigger, but it's an important subset, and maybe even the biggest importance is the implication for the patient's family, right? And for what Mike and others are doing, potential screening opportunities. So a couple of other questions here is one for Chris. Relationship between pancreatic steatosis and fibrosis.
Well, this is an area, I think if you're interested, there's hardly anything known. So this is a great area to study. I mean, we see a lot of these folks that have what appear to be either atrophy of the pancreas and replacement by fat, or just replacement, or just a lot of fat in a normal sized pancreas. Many of them have no symptoms. Some of them have exocrine insufficiency. It's not my sense that we see a lot of these folks getting pancreatitis or getting pancreatic cancer or getting chronic pancreatitis with the exception of developing exocrine insufficiency, but there's a lot we don't know. So I'm fascinated by it. And I think somebody in the audience should tackle that as an area of future research, because there's something there. I'm just not sure what.
Great.
I guess there's a follow-up then for me. Yeah. So following on what Chris said, so you have the metabolic syndrome, where you have fatty pancreas disease, as in the pancreas as well as the liver, and that's thought to be a modest risk factor. What I think Chris was alluding to is kind of more interesting. Sometimes you're getting fatty replacement when there's the acinar dropout and the fibrosis, and some of this potentially one day could be or detected by imaging. The pattern of the fat deposition is a little different if it's within the acini or the interlobular spaces versus sort of around the pancreas, where it's so there's a lot to understand. We think that probably is a worthwhile risk factor to kind of try and pursue and sort of understand, but we don't have a whole lot of data yet. We've been trying to study the pathologic slides, et cetera. I don't want to forget, Jin had a question as well, which may be one for Eileen. Do CAPS stage one patients need adjuvant chemo if they have no nodal metastases? So I've had the pleasure of hanging around some oncologists in my day. So I kind of have a little more of that aggressive, let's destroy the tumor whenever we can. But I think that's a question I'd like Eileen to answer.
Yeah, so thank you. So for stage one disease, if there's T1 and beyond these kind of microinvasion and a tiny focus of invasive cancer and IPPAN, those we struggle with what to do. But ductal adenocarcinoma, it's real. And the survival you showed is better, no question, for stage one, but it's still not as good, right, as for stage one for most other diseases. So yes, we do recommend adjuvant therapy, and as best you could tease out from the randomized trials, and the current reference would be with FOLFIRINOX. You know, the stage one patients did best, but they also, relatively speaking, had the best impact from adjuvant treatment. I think it's the tiny 2-3 millimeter ones. We don't know what to do with those and whether they really are the same disease or it's a different kind of spectrum. Great, and let's see, we have maybe one or two more here. So question, a number of patients enrolled in pancreas cancer screening programs develop advanced pancreas cancer, right? This is a very interesting one, despite screening, so and interval issues. And what are we learning from those and how can we change that? And is that biology, is that actually able to be intervened upon?
Yeah, so that's a great question. You know, there's a trade-off of for the general person getting surveillance, annual surveillance. You know, if you're starting at age 50, let's do every 6 months. So, you know, you don't want people to drop off. We're still accessing, you know, and the costs. So there is that tension there. Certainly, we think more and more that some of the interval cancers, you know, the Dutch have a lot of experience with the CDK N2A P16 mutation carriers. Their risk is quite high, and I think there's some emerging consensus maybe those folks merit 6 monthly surveillance. Any time we have, you know, kind of worrisome features, you know, but that often you'll find you had a pretty clean gland, and then you have pancreatic cancer. So, you know, 1 year later kind of thing. And even sometimes when you've had a cyst and you can still find a stage two, you know, kind of coming back 6 months or so later. And that doesn't even get into questions of interval. So yeah, the CAPS-5 data is a little bit different to the Dutch data. Not that they haven't had, you know, very good results with surveillance, but I think because they have more P16 CDK N2A carriers, that aspect has been there. And I think also maybe we're a little better, you know, than we used to be. So, you know, some of this data reflects cases diagnosed over a decade ago. So, you know, maybe we've been lucky a little bit with our CAPS-5 in terms of the actual numbers. It's hard to say, you know, that still remains a big concern. And that's one of the reasons why we want to try and complement the annual imaging with an interval blood test. That's a kind of a possibility. Of course, we need a good interval blood test, but you know, so this is a good question.
So maybe one other question on that. Do you want to comment on some of the emerging biomarkers from blood in terms of ctDNA, the methylation assays, and how you see those being integrated?
Yeah. So yeah, of course, very interesting area. You know, some of the tests are multi-cancer based tests, really, and so and where they may have and if the risk group that you're surveilling, you know, is more closer to general population, you know, they may have more value. I think, you know, from a high risk population point of view, I think we have enough data to say we wouldn't want to replace the imaging. And of course, if you had a different risk population, when you have a kind of a more closer to gold standard with imaging, these tests may not, you know, we know that ctDNA based tests haven't been as good at detecting stage one disease. They may downstage, but they're not yet at the stage one disease. And of course, you know, we're getting better with all sorts of enhancements, you know, using artificial intelligence tools, even for biomarkers. So, you know, I think it's a great time to be studying these. I think we still need some more work. I mean, I think for pancreas in particular, you know, you see that dramatic difference. If we're going to offer people surveillance, tests, even if it's a blood-based test, on a long-term basis, we want to be able to get them more often to a curative stage.
Excellent. Thanks so much. I think we have to close our panel here. Much and all, as it would be nice to continue this discussion, but perhaps we can come back to it in the breakout. So thank you, Dr. Goggins. Thanks, Dr. Forsmark and Dr. Gardner. And just to introduce the next part, we have a trivia question, right? That's the next thing to introduce. Yeah, here we go. So the pancreatic duct was named after its discoverer, Johann Georg Wirsum. And what country is he from? So you're asked not to answer in the chat, and no cheating, no Google. So the prize for whomever gets the questions right.